Because of our students are going abroad for medical education to other countries, that we should have private medical education in Sri Lanka. When a patient comes to you, you take a clear history, a detailed history. There are some people who will do a battery of investigations and pay scant attention to the history and examination. But I discourage that totally.
News First Exclusive with Emeritus Professor Sanath P. Lamapadusurya.
Hello there. Today we are joined by an absolute powerhouse and a pioneer in the medical industry of Sri Lanka. He is a well-known pediatrician here in Sri Lanka and internationally as well. And in fact, he completed 50 years in Sri Lanka of academic pediatrics this month. We are joined by none other than Professor Sanath Lamapadusurya. Good evening, Professor. First off, I would like to ask you that your career has now spanned for 50 years. You're celebrating 50 years of your career this month. How has been the experience? How has been the journey so far?
Well, I think the journey has been quite exciting.
Right.
I was fortunate to have my primary education in Royal Primary School and Royal College, and then I entered the Colombo Medical Faculty in 1962.
Right.
And I graduated in 1967, and so happened that I topped the combined order of merit for both universities of Peradeniya as well as Colombo. After completing my internship of 1 year, on the 1st of April 1969, I joined the Colombo Medical Faculty as a lecturer in pediatrics. Then in the early 70s, I went to England on a Colombo Plan scholarship. I was sent to acquire the MRCP and the DCH, which I acquired in 6 months. And then I had time left. I decided to get involved in research, and I went to the Institute of Child Health and the Hospital for Sick Children, Great Ormond Street, London, and I did a PhD, which I completed in 2 years and 3 months. And I happened to be the first clinician to get a research degree at that time.
Right.
So I returned.
The first Sri Lancan.
The first Sri Lankan,
yes.
To get a first Sri Lankan clinician.
Clinician, yes.
And then I returned to the country at the beginning of 1975.
Right.
And I continued to work in Colombo as a senior lecturer.
Right.
And then I moved to the University of Rohna when they created a medical faculty in Rohna as the founder professor of pediatrics.
Right.
And we started at Mahamodhara with very, very meager facilities, resources. Later on, the faculty developed at Karapitiya. And then in 1991, when the chair fell vacant in Colombo, I returned to Colombo.
Right.
Now, the time in Galle, I was very fortunate to be involved in a very big research project with some doctors from England and Norway, dealing with patients with unoperated cleft lips and palates. This project went on for many years, and at that time, although the war was going on, this team operated on over 700 patients successfully from all over the country, and they followed up these patients post-operatively, because they want to study the growth of the middle third of the face. That project resulted in the largest database for unoperated cleft lips and palates in the world.
Right.
And the BBC got interested. They came over to Galle and made a film about the project.
Right.
Which they telecast on national TV on Channel 4 called QED.
Right.
And so happened that this particular film won an award. And several academics got research degrees here as well as in England. And as a result of this the contribution I had made, Her Majesty the Queen honored me with an MBE
right.
in 1992.
Right.
And at that time, I happened to be the only Sri Lankan domiciled in this country to have received a royal honor. Now, when that project started, Sri Lanka had only one speech therapist, and she was in the private sector.
Right.
There was an anonymous donor who wanted to make a donation for some project involved with cleft palates anywhere in the world.
Right.
So Michael Maas, the co-director of the project, sent a copy of that BBC film to her, and she decided to donate £200,000 to train speech therapists in Sri Lanka. So with the seed money, the University of Kelaniya started training speech therapists in 1997. And at present, there are over 70 or 80 speech therapists all over Sri Lanka. And it's all because of this cleft lip and palate project, which gave me a lot of satisfaction.
Professor, now, currently the health industry, the medical industry of Sri Lanka is at a very technically advanced era and a technically advanced state. Back then, I believe that you didn't have such equipment, such technicalities. What do you see as the difference now and then? Is it better now with the technicalities or is it worse?
Well, I think it's a good mix, because I think when we were young doctors,
right,
there are no CT scans, not even ultrasound scans.
Right.
And MRI scans and PET scans, those are not heard of. So the way we were trained as medical students was based on taking a very good history and doing a thorough clinical examination, and then decide on a few investigations to be done, if necessary, to confirm the diagnosis.
Right.
And now I have been a teacher for the last 50 years, and still I train the students to follow the same path. After taking a clear history and examination, then if one needs to, one can request for some investigations, but not the other way around. Because these modern investigations, although health services are provided free by the Ministry of Health, it costs the government a lot of money.
Yes.
And therefore, one should not abuse these resources.
Let me interrupt you for a second. Professor, we are moving on to a short commercial break. I will see you on the other side. Hello there. Welcome back. We are joined by Professor Sanath Lama Badusurya. Once again, we are having an interesting discussion on the differences between the health and medical sector now and back then. Professor, you may continue.
Yes. Now, over the last 50 years, I have been teaching generations of medical students. Quite often I have taught the parents as well as their sons and daughters. But the message that I give to them is not to rely too much on sophisticated investigations.
Right.
They should stick to the basics. When a patient comes to you, you take a clear history, a detailed history, then you do a thorough physical examination, and then you request for relevant investigations, keeping the cost in mind, to confirm your diagnosis or for guidance.
Right.
But there are no shortcuts.
Yes.
You see, there are some people who will do a battery of investigations and pay scant attention to the history and examination. But I discourage that totally.
Right.
Because it's a waste of sort of expensive resources if one does that.
Okay.
So that's my message to the students.
Right. Professor, now currently you are a visiting professor in the Faculty of Medicine in University of Rajarhat, am I correct?
That's correct, yes.
So you meet and teach a lot of young people. You
yes.
meet a lot of budding doctors and budding a lot of talented people in this industry. What do you have to say to them? What do you have to say in terms of what have you been through in this journey of 50 years? What is your advice to them?
My advice to them is, first of all, their number one ambition should be to leave the faculty after graduating as soon as possible. Not to get involved in trade union activities,
right.
which will delay their graduation.
Right.
Because they have got into the medical faculty after qualifying in a very, very competitive exam.
Right.
And then they must make use of that opportunity to graduate as soon as possible, if necessary, if they wish to specialize and serve the country. Because I think quite a lot of students, they are from a poor background.
Yes.
And they should think of what they can do for their families before trying to sort of make or break the country.
Right.
So try to graduate first, earn a living, support your family, specialize, and serve the country.
Right.
The other thing is, now there's a very powerful trade union called the GMOA.
Yes.
And most of the doctors, soon after they graduate, they join that association.
Right.
I tell them that before they go on strike, think of the poor patients. Because when the doctors go on strike,
right,
it is the poor patients who suffer. The affluent patients can come to the private sector and take treatment. But the poor patients who travel long distances, when they come to an outpatient department to seek treatment, if the doctors are on strike, they have lost their daily wages, they are spent on traveling, and they are disappointed. So it is the poorest who are hit the hardest.
Yes.
So I tell them, think twice before striking. Right. Of course, on certain issues, politicians can understand only that language, so it's a powerful weapon, but don't misuse it. That's right. My message.
Right. Now, Professor, this is going to be a bit of a tricky question. Let's say that a student who had passed his or her O-levels and then qualified enough for her or his higher studies, what do you prefer for that student? A private sector university, in terms of it's fast, it's quick, you can obtain the degree fast, or state institution, where, as you said, a lot of protests and a lot of, a little bit of time wasting is involved there as well. In that, against that backdrop, what do you prefer for a student?
I would prefer a student to enter a state university.
Right.
Because medical education abroad is extremely expensive.
Yes.
Extremely expensive.
Right.
The students who go abroad for medical education are the students who have failed to get into a state university, although they have, some have got very good results.
Okay.
Couple of A's and a B. But because of this district quota business, etc., you see, which are not changed over the years, they fail to get into a state university and then they go abroad to a foreign university, and the parents don't have their children with them for the next 5 years, and they spend millions and millions of rupees. Now, I know of a medical school in China,
right,
where there are more than 100 Sri Lankan students per batch in that university.
In China?
In China. And sometimes Sri Lankan doctors go there to teach these students because they have to come back and sit for this ERPM examination.
Yes.
You see, there, so there are so many Sri Lankan students studying abroad.
Right.
And now that's the next thing I want to mention.
Right.
That we should have facilities for private medical education in our country. There are several advantages. One thing is we have the human resources.
Yeah.
The second thing is the students will be charged less money than if they go abroad for private medical education. And also, it should be monitored, and the admission should be strictly monitored by the UGC.
Right.
But it will cost less money, and the training would be better. And the Sri Lanka Medical Council could monitor the training.
Right.
And there are several advantages. And also, it will be a good foreign exchange earner for the country, because students from abroad will come to Sri Lanka to study medicine, because our medical education has got an excellent reputation in other countries.
We will be moving on to another commercial break. We will be right back. Welcome back. We are still with Professor Sanath Lama Badusuri, and an interesting question to post, Professor. Now, a lot of people who get their degrees and who go abroad, very well intellectual, erudite, educated people, they engage in this health sector business, and it is the sole purpose of it is to treat the people for their well-being and for their health. Most of the people, they go abroad they obtain their degree or higher education diploma, most of them don't come back to Sri Lanka, to your motherland.
Yeah, it's an important and interesting question.
Yes.
Now, it's referred to as the brain drain.
Yes.
Now, when we graduated, I graduated in 1967, and the Peradeniya Medical School, which is second medical school in Sri Lanka, the first batch graduated in January of 1967.
Right.
And during their internship, they were told that they won't be offered employment in the Ministry of Health. And they were given a few hundred rupees to be attached to GPs to be trained in general practice. At that time, there was an exam called the ECFMG, which was conducted in Colombo. And most of us sat for that exam because there was job uncertainty in the Ministry of Health. And everyone who sat for that exam passed that exam. It was a very easy exam to pass. And then they were offered jobs in the US. And that's the time the brain drain started. By the time we finished our internship, we were offered jobs, and we didn't. So therefore, that doubt was removed from our minds. But from that time, doctors have been going abroad, I think, to earn, probably for economic reasons, not for anything else. Then there's another issue. Now, our doctors currently are sent abroad for specialized training, mainly to the UK, to Australia, New Zealand, etc. Now, some of the doctors, they don't return after acquiring the degrees. And they are bonded. And sometimes they pay back the bond, but remain overseas. It's interesting that in the field of psychiatry, there are more Sri Lankan psychiatrists working for the National Health Service in the UK than the number of psychiatrists found in Sri Lanka. So that just shows how much of our valuable human resources have been lost to the country over the years. And I feel that because of our students are going abroad for medical education to other countries, that we should have private medical education in Sri Lanka.
Right.
Because we have the human resources, we can ensure quality. Those students' admission should be monitored by the University Grants Commission. The Sri Lanka Medical Council has the power to maintain standards, to closely monitor the standards, and probably it will be less expensive to have for the course fee compared to what they are charging abroad. I think it may be maybe about 25% of the fee that they charge abroad. That if we have, and there's a lot of scope for our doctors. Some people think that we may have too many doctors. Right. Well, if we have too many doctors, those doctors could go abroad and earn a living. It's much better than sending housemaids to the Middle East. You're to sending medical professionals abroad. It has much more dignity than sending housemaids to the Middle East.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Right.
The one other thing, I don't know whether I mentioned it.
Right.
2 years ago, I was invited to be a consultant to set up a faculty of medicine in the Sabarmati University.
Right.
And in January this year, the faculty was opened in Ratnapura by the Prime Minister, and 70 students were enrolled in that faculty. So over the years, University of Colombo, University of Ruhuna, University of Rajarata, and lastly to the Sabarmati University. And that has given me a lot of satisfaction.
Thank you very much, Professor Sanath Lamavadu Suri, for joining with us today. It was an absolute pleasure and an honor to interview you this evening. And I wish you very best in your future endeavors as well. And I would like to say that inspire more youngsters, aspiring youngsters here in Sri Lanka. And with that, we bring this interview to a close. A very good night and take care.